breezy again. So I promised you I would watch Pinocchio. I'm pleasantly surprised. I remember Pinocchio not being my favorite. I didn't expect to enjoy it so much. What I decided to do this time, though, is to actually go in depth about Pinocchio and to find out about how it was made, who did what, all sorts of things. And it actually made me enjoy the film a lot more. So Pinocchio was released in 1940. It was based on an 1883 book called The Adventures of Pinocchio. One of the animators at Disney, named Norman Ferguson, brought Disney a translated copy, and Disney loved it so much, they said he busted a gut with enthusiasm. He commissioned a storyboard artist named Bianca Maggioli. I hope I'm saying that right. She wrote a new outline and new story for the whole book. Funny story, Bambi was supposed to come out first. They weren't happy with how the story was going forward, and they weren't happy with the animation. They wanted it to be more lifelike, so they paused that and they developed Pinocchio first. Pinocchio took $2.6 million to make. Now, it was deemed kind of a failure because it only made anywhere from $1.4 million to $1.9 million. There are different theories on this. One of the biggest theories is that World War II was happening, so they couldn't go to the international audiences, such as Asia or Europe. Now here's the crazy bit. In 1987, a sequel was made. Not by Disney, but by a company called Filmation. It's called Pinocchio and the Emperor of the Night.
Hey, how are you?
Me?
You look a lot like a puppet I saw once. Name was Pistachio.
That's Pinocchio.
Because the world needs all the magic. Music and adventure it can get. Filmation proudly presents
Coming Toward Me Through the Moonlight was a band of pirates.
Pinocchio and the Emperor of the Night.
No. So let's get on to the movie. So the title screen is made out of wood, obviously. It looks really nice. There are random capital letters again all through the credits. And we hear Jiminy Cricket. We don't know his name yet, but we all know his name. Jiminy Cricket is singing When You Wish Upon a Star. Jiminy was actually played by a famous ukulele and singer. Jiminy was actually played by a famous singer and ukulele player named Cliff Edwards. Disney wanted to have more big names in the movie, so this was one of his ways to do it. In the book, Jiminy was originally a 100-year-old wise cricket. His story wasn't as big in the book. The biggest part in the whole book is that Pinocchio smashes him with a mallet and Jiminy comes back as a ghost. Awkward. I went through the credits. As follows, we had the animation direction, there were 8 people. Art direction, 10 people. Background, only 4 people, and only 22 animators. I only assume that they just kind of spread people out better. In Snow White, I only noticed 24 animators. I feel like between Snow White and Pinocchio, being that Snow White was such a big success, they were able to reorganize and to make their teams up better. So we open up on the classic book scene again. Jiminy Cricket is up at the top singing. He's in his fancy duds, and we'll talk about, you know, when he gets his fancy duds later, but he's singing. It's beautiful. One of the most classic songs in Disney, I think. I think most people know this song. He's singing, and we see the book that has Pinocchio's profile on it and Pinocchio written on it. But then in the corner, we see books. Alice in Wonderland, Peter Pan, and also we see Geppetto's glasses sitting there, so that's pretty cool. So let's talk about Jiminy before we get too far in the story. Jiminy Cricket, like I said, he wasn't a big part of the book, but when they started going through the story of Pinocchio and animating Pinocchio, Walt Disney didn't like that he was so helpless. So they created the Jiminy character to guide him through the whole story. Jiminy Cricket was originally animated to look like a cricket with the little tooth saw feet, legs, and the antennae wiggling all over the place. Walt Disney didn't really like that. He thought it wasn't likable enough. So a man called Ward Kimball had worked on Snow White, and he worked on 2 scenes that were actually cut from Snow White. And rumor is he was about to quit, but Disney wanted to reward him for his hard work, so he promoted him to head animator of Jiminy Cricket. Kimball later described Jiminy Cricket as an egg-shaped head of a little man with no ears, and he's a cricket because we said he's a cricket.
I'll bet a lot of you folks don't believe that.
So it appears that the opening of the story is after the whole story happens. Jiminy's talking about how, I bet you don't believe wishes come true, but here's why I believe they come true. And he opens the book with his umbrella, book tries to close again on him because he's tiny. And then he uses the candlestick to keep the book open. We then pan in on the book on this small town. Now, I wanted to know more about the small town. It really wasn't based on anywhere in particular, except that they based it on Italy, because the book is Italian originally. So you can see small things. They did go kind of the Europe look, and it's beautiful. The scenery is just beautiful. We are zooming in into the town, and we see the North Star, which is later we find the Blue Fairy. Some people say it's also Neverland, but for right now, the star is a wishing star. Jiminy is coming into town, and he's noting how it's a sleepy little town, and there's only one light on in the whole town, and it's a woodcarver shop of Geppetto. And so he hops over, which is fun because the whole camera light goes, dude, dude. Right up into the window, and I thought that was a pretty cool thing to do. I did look up Geppetto's workshop as well. Funnily enough, there was a Geppetto's workshop, and they took it out so that there can be a Tangled meet and greet. Also, there is a Geppetto's workshop. I found their online site. They're in Wisconsin. Just a little toy shop. So we see Jiminy looking in the window. He's in worn clothes, the typical kind of hobo look. He has toeless shoes, and his hat has a little tear in it, and he's got holes in his gloves. He has a carpet bag and an umbrella. So he talks about how he doesn't want a good fire to go to waste. He sneaks under the door, hops over to the fire, gets a little coal, and he warms himself. Looks around the shop. He sees all sorts of things. I noticed a lot of fun stuff in the scenery. Like, a lot of the pots have faces. I thought that was kind of cool because that kind of goes back to Snow White. They had a lot of, like, pots and things with faces, I thought. And so he's looking around and he sees Pinocchio. Let's talk about Pinocchio for a second. We don't know his name's Pinocchio yet, but we all know these things. I mean, it's kind of hard to go back and be like, I don't know what this puppet's name is when we all know what this puppet's name is. Anyway, so Pinocchio's design. The animators kept on trying to make Pinocchio a puppet, and Disney wasn't impressed. He's like, I don't find him relatable. I don't like that he's so wooden puppety. And so one of the animators said, well, why don't we just make him a boy, a cute little boy, and we'll go backwards, just add joints and add things to make him look puppetish. And Disney liked that design. So Jiminy's drawn to Pinocchio. He comes over and he climbs up and he's like, ah, solid piece of wood too. Stuff like that. And then Geppetto comes in. And Geppetto is finishing touches on Pinocchio, some paint and things. Geppetto finishes the puppet and names him Pinocchio. And he asks Figaro, do you like the name? And Figaro's like, what about you, Cleo? Cleo's the fish. And then he asks Pinocchio and he makes him with his string say. So he decides to test out Pinocchio. He brings him down and he sings Little Wooden Head. The song is played by one of the many, many music box. In Geppetto's shop, there are clocks, music box, and toys. It seems Pinocchio's the only puppet, I just realized. So he turns on the song, and lots of scene with Jiminy watching the little guy whistle and then pretending to be a trumpeter with his umbrella. And so there's a lot, and he got stuck under the, well, he hid under the music box and got hit by a bunch of gears. Lots of stuff with Jiminy. Jiminy is just such a great character. He makes Pinocchio get into all sorts of hijinks. And then he kicks Figaro, and Figaro gets right back at him and swats his foot and gets him all tangled. And Geppetto says, you see what happens? And I feel like that is one of the main themes of the whole story is actions and consequences. Oh, I always wondered how the strings, so Geppetto spins him really fast. How did the strings not get tangled? I mean, I work with yarn, obviously, and I get my yarn freaking tangled. You look at it and it tangles. So obviously Figaro is jealous, and so Geppetto picks up Figaro by the scruff, and I thought maybe it was a one-time thing, but, like, pretty much all through the movie, Geppetto picks up Figaro by the scruff. Can't we just, like, grab him by his little belly and pick him up, maybe? He's talking to Figaro about, oh, it's okay, don't be jealous, and then all the clocks go off. There is a duck clock, a bee, a mama bird with her babies, a turkey avoiding his fate, a man shooting at a bird, a drunk man hiccuping, and a young child being spanked for getting jam all over. They even had the jam prints, like, on the side of the clock. So 7 clocks that I counted. And then Geppetto says, I wonder what time this is. And he takes out his little pocket watch, and it's 2 men, dink, dink, they're cheersing beer. And he's like, oh, it's getting very late. So he makes Figaro say goodnight. He says goodnight to Pinocchio, and he makes Figaro say goodnight to Pinocchio, and then he makes Figaro say goodnight to Cleo. And Cleo is obviously a fish, and Cleo's like ready for her kiss up against the glass. Figaro licks the glass, and Cleo's all happy and pretty. And Jiminy decides to make his bed on the handle of a violin and says, ah, comfort. Solid comfort. Then we cut to Geppetto. He's in his gown and his little cap, and he's smoking a pipe. Funnily enough, there are four more pipes on the wall next to him. And his bed is obviously carved out of wood, but I couldn't really tell the carvings. Sometimes you can see some animals and faces. It just wasn't a focus, so they didn't really, like, you know, make that crisp, I think. However, Figaro's bed is adorable. It has a little cat angel above his head, and then at his feet has little mice carved into it. And he has a little patchwork blanket and a sandbox next to his bed, included with bucket and spade. Geppetto keeps Figaro up with his musings about, oh, I wish Pinocchio was a real boy. Figaro looks extremely annoyed, like me when I get woken up at 1 a.m. by some dog that needs to pee. Figaro just gets comfy and is ready to go to sleep when Geppetto's like, oh no, I forgot to open the window. So Figaro kicks off his blankets angrily and goes to the window and opens it up. And then Geppetto sees the wishing star, and all of a sudden he can get out of bed. So he gets out of bed, starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight, I wish I might have the wish I wish tonight. Now, I always thought you couldn't tell your wishes, but I mean, for the movie, it kind of works. He tells Figaro, who is still sleepy and doesn't care, that he wishes Pinocchio was a real boy, and Figaro's like, uh-huh. Jiminy, on the other hand, is listening to the wish and says, what a lovely thought. Not practical. So Figaro's tired of this crap. He just gets in bed with Geppetto and they go to sleep. Jiminy is trying to go to sleep and all the clocks are going off really loudly. And then the snoring of Geppetto and... Quiet!
After all, enough's enough.
Then he's trying to go to sleep and the room's lighting up and the star is getting brighter and brighter and brighter and coming into the room, and he hides before the star gets to the room, and it turns out it's the Blue Fairy. Now, the Blue Fairy was in the book. She was supposed to have turquoise hair, hence her name. She was childlike and she lived in a cottage in the forest. Pinocchio saw her as his mother figure, and she had no connection to the wishing star. The Blue Fairy actually shared the same live model as Snow White and was made by rotoscoping, where they trace over the picture of a live person and animate it. Learn something new every day. I actually loved the Blue Fairy's appearance. She was skinny and tiny, but like had a real physique, you know, not wasn't like, woo, her sparkly blue dress and how she was transparent. I just really loved all of that. So apparently she's here to reward Geppetto for being so good, and she's gonna grant his wish. She brings Pinocchio to life. She's telling Pinocchio, I brought you to life, but you're not a real boy. If you wanna be a real boy, I need you to be brave, truthful, and unselfish. And Jiminy's like, that won't be easy. And then she talks about a conscience, and then...
What are conscience?
What are conscience? I'll tell you. A conscience is that still, small voice that people won't listen to. That's just the trouble with the world today.
Are you my conscience?
So Pinocchio asks Jiminy if he's his conscience, and the Blue Fairy asks if he wants to be his conscience, and then Jiminy gets all red and goes... Uh-huh. So the Blue Fairy knights him as his conscience. He gets all these fancy duds. And then the Blue Fairy leaves with, be a good boy and always let your conscience be your guide. I actually paused here and the stardust is squiggles, like little squiggles. But that was very clever. So Jiminy decides to do a heart-to-heart talk with Pinocchio, which only confuses Pinocchio more and actually I think confuses Jiminy Cricket. But Pinocchio does exclaim he wants to do right. And so... that leads them into the song, Give a Little Whistle. At this point, Jiminy's dancing around the shop. It's mostly Jiminy focused at this point, and he's dancing around the shop. He sniffs into a pipe, and and like all the sounds are associated with Jiminy. He bounces on a saw, and it's like he's playing the saw, and then he jumps up onto a clock and flirts with a little milkmaid and then gets rejected. Pinocchio tries to join, and he ends up crashing into everything, kind of like Dopey did in Snow White. This obviously wakes Geppetto, Figaro, and Cleo up, and they're all looking around, freaking out. Immediately, Geppetto takes out this oversized handgun, probably appropriate for the time, but it looks kind of comical, and is walking around, freaking out, and Figaro's right underneath him, and then all of a sudden...
Here I am!
Chaos everywhere! But then Geppetto sees Pinocchio. He's like, oh, how'd you get down there? And he's picking him up and wait. And he realizes that Pinocchio's alive. he dumps water on himself because he thinks he's dreaming. And then Pinocchio is just like, oh, you're so funny. And Geppetto is overjoyed that Pinocchio has actually come to life. Pinocchio tells him about how he can be a real boy, but Geppetto's just so overjoyed he doesn't even care. And so he brings him down to say hello to Figaro, and Pinocchio literally says,
hello to Figaro.
When I was watching Snow White, I was a little upset about how gullible they made Snow White. In this one, it works because he literally was a puppet and he just came to life. Then he introduces Pinocchio to Cleo. Cleo jumps out of the water, kisses Pinocchio, and also kisses Figaro, which Figaro is very upset about this. Then Geppetto turns on a bunch of music boxes and starts dancing. Jiminy's so excited too, he starts dancing with one of the little wooden music box ladies. For Jiminy being a conscience, they sure played him as kind of a ladies' man. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, it just kind of surprised me that they would be like, oh yeah, he's a conscience, but he's also a ladies' man. As Geppetto starts gathering toys for Pinocchio, all of a sudden Pinocchio sees fire. Oh, pretty. Pinocchio sets himself on fire, which is when I realized he must not feel pain because he's on fire. Obviously, everyone freaks out, and Geppetto puts out Pinocchio's finger in the water. Then Geppetto says, we need to go to sleep. And Pinocchio asks why, need to go to school, why, you know, typical kids, why? Figaro is not pleased. And then eventually they go to bed. The next morning we zoom in on the town again, cheery music, kids everywhere, a kid trips over a dog, there's a goose girl, and then we go to Pinocchio and he's so excited, he's going to school. Geppetto gives Pinocchio an apple and his books and sends him off to school, and Geppetto's just as happy as can be, and Pinocchio heads off to school. Then we see a fox and a cat who are in clothes and they are walking on, and the fox is talking to Gideon, the cat, and the fox is talking about, knowledge, the best thing ever, kind of cynically, of course. And then he comes upon a poster for Stromboli's puppet show and talks about, that Stromboli's at it again kind of thing. And they keep walking and then...
A little wooden boy.
A wooden boy.
There's got to be a way to capitalize on this. And then he miraculously sees the poster next to his face, obviously. And we'll sell him to Stromboli. I think this is when he introduces himself as Honest John. Pinocchio is like, I'm going to school. And John is like, well, you obviously haven't heard of the easy way. And convinces Pinocchio to become an actor. And they sing...
An actor's life for me.
Pinocchio has a book and an apple, right? Well, while they're singing the song, they just disappear. I can't remember where they went, but I thought that was kind of funny. All of a sudden, they're gone. Jiminy overslept, and he's like, some conscious I am, and he's getting dressed and everything. And then he sees people coming, so he hides. And he's like, a parade. Da, 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 da. And then he hears Pinocchio's voice, and he's like, oh no! And so he runs after Pinocchio. He ends up in Honest John's hat. Gideon tries to hit him with a mallet, but hits Honest John instead. So Honest John's stuck in his hat, and that gives Jiminy an opportunity to talk to Pinocchio alone. So Jiminy gives Pinocchio a script to help him get away from the temptation, which he literally points to John and said, there you go, that's temptation, as they were talking about earlier. Pinocchio was like, okay, I got it, and then goes off with Honest John to the theater, and... Pinocchio is gone, and Jiminy's just trailing behind. It's really funny because Jiminy's like,
what'll I do? I'll run and tell his father. No, that'd be snitching. I'll go after him myself.
Go to the theater, the puppet show, and Stromboli's this big man, and he's getting the crowd all excited and talking about this new puppet that has no strings, I hope, he says. Then we see Pinocchio, and he sings, I've got no strings. Stromboli actually gets really mad at him at one point. And then here's where I noticed the green. So there's a few instances of green. We've got Stromboli with the green on his clothes. We've got Honest John with the green. Gideon has green eyes. And it's not always like in your face green, because obviously Jiminy Cricket's green, but he's not evil. So my theory is if they're evil, there will be green, but green does not always mean evil. Sure. This is also the point in the movie where I realized there's no love interest in this movie. Which kind of makes me really happy. Just between father and son. And I think there's a few movies coming up that won't have that. And that makes me really happy. because there was a point when I was a kid where everything was a love interest. So this made me pretty happy. The crowd really loves Pinocchio. It's funny, Jimmy's like, no interest in the puppet show. And then the ladies start dancing the lady puppets. And he's like, Jiminy's all for the ladies. Which again is fine. It's just not what I thought of a conscience. Jiminy starts questioning if he was wrong. And maybe he's not a good conscience. So he kind of just leaves.
Guess he won't need me anymore. What does an actor want with a conscience anyway?
This makes me so sad, this next scene. Geppetto and Cleo and Figaro are all waiting for Pinocchio, and he has this huge meal, and Pinocchio isn't there, and Geppetto goes out into the rain to look. They made a comic relief where Figaro wants to eat his fish, and Cleo scolds him. Still, the whole scene just made me sad. So Stromboli is eating off a sword, counting his money, talking to Pinocchio about all the things, and then he finds like a coin with a hole in it, which is funny because I collect coins and I have a few coins with a hole in it, but I think it was just like a button or something, but it was metal. So he bends it and he gets mad. Something in my eye. And we're back. So he gets really mad. He gives it to Pinocchio, kind of like, haha, I'll give you this because you're dumb. And then Pinocchio's like, great, I'll go tell my father. And Stromboli's drinking wine and he spits it everywhere. And he's like, go home, father. And he starts chuckling maniacally and then throws Pinocchio in a cage and says,
there, this will be your home where I can find you always.
No, no, no.
Yes, 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 to me. You are belonging. Angel of evil. You will make lots of money. For me!
We go to Jiminy sitting in the rain sadly, still musing like, well, I guess he doesn't need me. He's gonna be famous. And then he's like, well, I can at least wish him luck. So he does. He hops onto the coach and he gets in there and he's like,
Pinocchio, it's me. Your old friend Jiminy, remember?
They haven't just seen each other 5 minutes ago. And Pinocchio's so excited to see Jiminy. He was crying and Jiminy's like, oh no, what are you doing in there? And he tries to break Pinocchio out by picking the lock. He goes inside the lock and tries to pick the lock, but he can't. And then they're both very sad that he can't pick the lock. Pinocchio and Jiminy play the blame game. Oh, I'm a bad conscience. Oh, I should have listened to you. And then all of a sudden, the blue fairy's coming and they panic. Pinocchio tries to hide, Jiminy tries to hide, and the fairy's like, what happened? And Pinocchio starts lying. Here's the funny thing. I thought the lying thing was a lot more of the movie. It's a very small part. But anyway, Pinocchio's nose grows. And she just kind of...
Two big monsters with big green eyes.
Monsters? Weren't you afraid?
No, ma'am, but they tied me in a big sack.
You don't say.
Lets him lie. Like, just lets him lie. His nose grows, and the blue fairy says, a lie can grow so big it's as plain as the nose on your face. He says, I'll never lie again, and... She helps him just this once, and she puts his nose back to rights, unlocks the door. And so Pinocchio and Jiminy escape and leave Stromboli behind. Then we go back to Geppetto searching in the rain for Pinocchio, and my heart is breaking the whole time. We then go to John, Gideon, and someone we don't know, who we later find out is the coachman. And they are at a bar drinking and smoking, which happens a lot in this movie. Huh. Wouldn't fly today. John is talking about how they got away with this thing and he puts a little bag of money on the table, talking about how he is such a con man and look what he did. The coachman brings out a huge sack of money and is like, how'd you like to make some real money? The coachman says he has a proposition. John says, who do they have to? And so he says kill without ever saying kill. But that was kind of clever. The coachman says he's collecting stupid boys who play hooky from school. Then he whispers the rest to John. Then he stops whispering to say, and then I take them to Pleasure Island. And John freaks. Pleasure Island, but the law. The coachman says they never come back as boys. Now, this is the part I realized there's no green on the coachman. Here's why I think that is. Because he's wearing red, and when he says as boys, his face goes red and his hair turns into a kind of horns. So maybe they were trying to get at he's kind of like the devil. My theory. So Pinocchio's hopping along, going back home, happy as a clam. And then all of a sudden, Honest John and Gideon are there. Honest John convinces Pinocchio he's having a nervous breakdown and then convinces him that he's allergic. and that he needs a vacation on Pleasure Island. Pinocchio does his best to resist this. No, I'm going to school. No, no, I'm okay. No, no, thank you, kind of thing. But then Honest John and Gideon literally pick him up and take him with them. Then we are on the carriage, but Jiminy's down at the bottom in his umbrella, like hanging there, like, here we go again. I really feel like Pinocchio was drug against his will, pretty much. Pinocchio's sitting at the front of the carriage, and he's with Lampy, who is wearing green. Pinocchio follows Lampy. This makes sense to me because Lampy is a real boy, and Lampy answers his questions. Maybe not in the best way, but he answers them. So they're on Pleasure Island. Pleasure Island was an interesting concept to me, so I had to read up on it. For the longest time, I thought it was the alcohol that turned the little boys into donkeys. Apparently, Pleasure Island is supposed to have been built, possibly by the coachman, but it's a cursed island, where if the little boys are bad, they turn themselves into jackasses. There's a lot of people saying that word. It's not my favorite word. But basically, the coachman says, give a boy enough rope, he'll make a jackass out of himself. Again, not my favorite word. Donkey. It's not that I'm against swearing, it's just I don't like that word. So anyway, the island provides everything a little boy could want. Fights, breaking things, alcohol, smokes, and according to the legend of the island, if you continue being bad, you'll turn into a donkey. Now, where this goes back to the original book, donkey in Italian is synonymous for stupid. So that kind of made sense to me. So Pinocchio's following around Lampy. The end of the night, everyone's gone. And Pinocchio is with Lampy playing pool. Jiminy has been looking for Pinocchio this whole time and still hasn't found him. Lampy teaches Pinocchio how to smoke and they're drinking. And when Pinocchio takes a big drag of the cigar, he gets sick. That's when Jiminy comes in and starts scolding him. Lampy makes fun of Jiminy and calls him a grasshopper. This seems to be a very big insult to Jiminy. But then Pinocchio says, don't hurt him, Jiminy. He's my best friend. And this really hurts Jiminy's feelings because he feels like, oh, I'm just your conscience. And so Jiminy takes off. Jiminy decides he wants to leave. So he's at the front doors. And this is when he finds all the donkeys. And this is the scene where we find out what's going on with the donkeys. And the donkeys, if they can't speak, if they're a real donkey, he takes off their items and he puts them in a crate. One's head to the circus, one's head to the salt mine. So obviously he's selling them. I don't feel this is a very lucrative business. Maybe, I don't know how he would have made a profit. I mean, all the destruction, alcohol, and cigars alone. Anyway, he takes out another donkey, and this one's named Alexander, and we know because Alexander can still talk. Throws Alexander with a bunch of other little donkeys that can talk. There are theories what happens to these donkeys. I don't like any of them, so I shall not name them here. Jiminy runs back to Pinocchio, but while he's running back to Pinocchio, Lampy starts turning into a donkey. Here's where I think I didn't like the movie, because Lampy's turning into a donkey, and I think it freaked me out a little. Lampy turning into a donkey makes Pinocchio stop smoking, stop drinking. The transformation also freaked Pinocchio out, so I wasn't the only one. Pinocchio starts to turn into a donkey, but he doesn't turn all the way. Jiminy catches up to him, and they leave the island by jumping into the water. I have some theories of why Pinocchio didn't turn into a donkey all the way. Number one, they left the island. So before Pinocchio could turn into a donkey all the way, he left the island and therefore only turned into a donkey partway. Number two, he didn't really go to the island willingly. He doesn't really understand what's going on. I mean, he knows that they're being bad, but it's not like he wanted to be bad. It's not like he chose to go to the island. He was kind of drugged there. And number three, he's not a real boy, so he can't turn into a real donkey. Pinocchio and Jiminy, they return home and they're so excited. They're banging on the door, but then Geppetto isn't there and there's cobwebs and dust and Pinocchio is really worried something awful happened. And we get a glowing dove with a letter for them. I think it's really cute. Jiminy reads it because obviously Pinocchio can't read it. He hasn't come to school yet. So Jiminy reads it and he's reading it really calmly.
Where is he?
Why, it says here he went looking for you and he was swallowed by a whale.
Swallowed by a whale?
Yeah, A whale? A whale named Monstro.
And then Jiminy gets on board with how crazy that sounds. And Pinocchio, without even thinking, starts walking for the coastline. And he's just determined to go save Geppetto. So Pinocchio starts tying a rock to his tail. And Jiminy absentmindedly uses his umbrella so that he can tie another knot. And then Pinocchio's like, goodbye, Jiminy. And then Jiminy's like, goodbye.
Tie it good and tight now. And besides, it's dangerous. Why,
bye, Jiminy.
Goodbye.
I may be live bait down there, but I'm with you. Come on.
Let's go. Look out below!
So they jump into the water and they sink to the bottom. And Pinocchio is dragging the rock along with them. There's a really cute scene where Jiminy's trying to figure out how to stay underwater. And so he puts a rock in his hat that flips him over. This little fish has got a crush on him, I guess. And so then Jiminy puts the rock in his pants. That rock later disappears, which kind of weirded me out. But, you know, cartoons. The coloring in the underwater scene, there was so much good scenery in the rest of the movie. But in the underwater scene, everything was so muted, except for anything that moved was super colorful. This might have been on purpose, it just wasn't my favorite thing. So Jiminy's pursued by that little fish that has a crush on him, and he gets mad at it, and then I guess the daddy fish comes up, but then Jiminy asks about Monstro the Whale, and whoosh, they're gone. There's several scenes of this where the fish are following Pinocchio. He asks them about Monstro, they run. Jiminy and Pinocchio go through some seaweed, there's some seahorses, they ask about Monstro, they run. Several scenes of that. While these two are looking, we go to a huge whale at the bottom of the ocean, obviously Monstro. We go inside, there is Geppetto on a broken boat with Figaro and Cleo, and they have no food. They're fishing, there's no food. And Geppetto happens to say, if the monster doesn't wake up and eat soon, we're going to starve. Then, obviously, a school of fish comes by and Monstro decides to eat. Pinocchio and Jiminy get swept up in this, and luckily, Jiminy has the foresight to untie the rock, and so Monstro is chasing all these fish, and Geppetto's inside fishing and getting fish for days and telling Figaro, keep them in there, and Figaro's doing a really good job trying to keep those fish in there, even though they're three times his size. Finally, Monstro catches Pinocchio. Pinocchio shoots himself out of the water, and then for dramatic effect, Monstro goes clamp onto him. But Geppetto is still inside fishing and catches Pinocchio. And there's a big reunion and they're so happy. Then Pinocchio sneezes and Geppetto tries to warm him up, takes off his hat, sees the ears. Pinocchio is about to explain what happened and he never did. Geppetto just kind of like, ah, don't worry about it. I still love you. You're my little wooden head. And meanwhile, Jiminy's stuck outside. The teeth are closed and Jiminy's like, let me in. And the seagulls are trying to get him. So Jiminy hides in a bottle so that the seagulls can't get him. So Pinocchio's trying to figure out how to get him out, and Geppetto's kind of being like, oh no, that won't work. I built a raft, but that's not going to work. But then Pinocchio comes up with the idea of making Monstro sneeze, and so they start a big fire. When Monstro finally does sneeze, Jiminy's like, oh great, and he goes in, and then he's like, wait, which way we're going? And they go out, and so when Monstro sneezes, they're out. But then he's like breathing in to sneeze again. And so it brings them back in and then finally back out. After that, Monstro's really angry and just decides this little raft must have been the cause of it. And so he goes after him and he's chasing him and then he smashes the raft. And then Pinocchio sees Geppetto falling into the water and Geppetto keeps saying, save yourself, save yourself. Pinocchio grabs him, drags him, sees a cave, gets him to the cave, the monster just slams into the side of the cliff and Pinocchio and Geppetto make it through the cave. At this point, we see Geppetto wash up. We see Figaro and Cleo, who is still in her bowl. They all wash up and Geppetto's still mumbling, save yourself. Jiminy washes up and finds Pinocchio face down in the water with very dramatic music. We cut to them at home. Pinocchio is laying on the bed. Geppetto's crying on the bed. Figaro and Cleo are very sad and Jiminy's also crying. All of a sudden, the blue fairy comes in and says that Pinocchio has been brave, truthful, and unselfish. I can see brave, I can see unselfish, but I never saw truthful. He lied and then never really came clean to the blue fairy. She just forgave him, which is fine. Forgiveness is a great virtue, but that wasn't part of the deal. Then when Geppetto asks him what happened, I mean, he started to try to explain, but Geppetto just said, no, it's okay. So maybe that counts? Anyway, the blue fairy brings him to life and he's a real boy. And then Pinocchio wakes up and is like, Father, look, I'm awake, I'm alive, I'm a real boy. And Geppetto's like, just lay back down. And Pinocchio's like, no, look. And then they all celebrate, they're all happy. Figaro even gets into the fishbowl and kisses Cleo. All the clocks and all the music boxes are going off and Jiminy looks out the window and climbs over and goes out the window. Looks up at the star and says thank you for making him a real boy. He really deserves it. And then the light shines on Jiminy, and he gets an 18-karat gold badge that says he's a conscience. Jiminy then starts singing When You Wish Upon a Star Again as we kind of pan out, and the end title says The End, a Walt Disney production. I really did like this movie. Again, not one of my favorites where I'd just be like, let's watch Pinocchio. I mean, if I was babysitting and they said we'd watch Pinocchio, I'd be like, yeah, let's do it. But I wouldn't maybe choose it myself. But I really enjoyed getting into the backstory of it. I hope you really enjoyed it too. I almost forgot the crocheted character of the movie. Jiminy Cricket this week with included tails and his little top hat. See you next time.